gentlemen, welcome. I'm delighted to see so many of you here this evening for the third annual lecture of our Institute for Public Policy and Professional Practice, which this year forms part of our Festival of Ideas, a month-long cornucopia of activities running from around about the end of January to the beginning of March. So this year I'm delighted to welcome Professor Kate Pickett, who's Professor of Epidemiology at the University of York, to deliver the annual lecture. Kate studied at Cambridge and Cornell and Berkeley, and she runs her research group at York, where she is the co-author of The Spirit Level. And 2 years ago, those of you who were here for Richard Wilkinson's lecture will, I'm sure, be interested to hear what she has to say, and perhaps with different emphasis to what Richard presented to us then. She's very kindly agreed to take some questions at the end as well, and John Diamond, the director of I4P, will chair that particular session. So without any further ado, Professor Kate Pickett.
Thank you so much. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you all for coming. 2 years ago, my colleague Richard Wilkinson came and spoke at the launch of the Institute, and I think described to those of you who were here then our research on the impact of inequality on health and social problems. I'm going to assume that not all of you were here then, but that some of you might have been. So I'm not going to cover exactly the same ground. What I'll try and do tonight is talk more in depth about how inequality affects us, how it gets under the skin and affects all of us, and therefore the prevalence of health and social problems in populations. But I also want to talk a bit about how research can be translated into either policy or activism and campaigning, and what the role of researchers should be when their research has potential impact for social justice and change in society. Because it's not always easy thinking what that role should be, or how far you take your research into that arena. So those are the sorts of things I want to cover, and then I'll try and leave us plenty of time for questions and discussion at the end, because I'd love to hear your thoughts. I mean, the reason why we're interested in the effects of inequality is because life in our modern developed societies is not always all it should be. If you think about our grandparents' generation, or a bit before, talking to them about the material comfort we now live in, I think that they would all expect us to be living in paradise, really. Most of us are warm, most of us are well-fed, many of us overfed, indeed. Most of us have access to lots of the things we sort of need to be comfortable, but we're not always happy, and we're not always well. And Richard and I have become very fond of this photograph because it really illustrates the dysfunction in society today. This was taken outside Oxford Tube station on a working day morning. So these are all young people going to work, so they're all employed, and they are all miserable. You know, there's not a smile on a single face. Some of them look on the point of tears, others on the point of rage. Then none of them communicating with anything other than their telephones, and they really look, I don't know, quite distressed. So we're interested in how it is that our society exhibits so much social and health dysfunction when we live in such a materially comfortable world. And that's really been the spark for the kind of research we do. And both Richard and I are epidemiologists. That means we study the health of populations rather than individuals. It means we use statistical methods to do our work. And one thing we've realized is that a lot of people loathe statistics, skip tables and graphs in newspapers, books, or articles. So if you can understand this chart, you've got the picture, right? That's as complicated as it needs to be. When inequality rises in a society, problems increase. So if you've got that, you've got the message. And that really was what our book, The Spirit Level, was all about. It was laying out the evidence for that in detail and in a rather sort of hitting you over the head again and again and again kind of way with the evidence. This graph shows our index of health and social problems for various countries, which contains all of the things listed on the right. So it's got measures of population health, how long people live in society, rates of infant deaths, levels of mental illness. It's also got measures of trust, violence and imprisonment, so measures of social cohesion, and also things that are about children's chances in life, educational scores, social mobility, teenage births, etc. And putting all of those things into an index and comparing the rich developed market democracies, those with low levels of income inequality on the left, Japan and the Scandinavian countries, have a much lower level of all of those health and social problems than the more unequal countries on the right, USA, Portugal, UK. And in our book, what we did was show this for all of those separate kinds of health and social problems and discuss why that might be so. And I'm just going to show you one of those individual components of the index to illustrate the scale of the differences, and also because it's quite a key one for thinking about how inequality works to affect us all. This is levels of mental illness in rich developed nations. The data come from the World Health Organization, and people used to think that you couldn't compare levels of mental illness in different societies because healthcare provision is different, there are different cultural ideas around what mental illness is or isn't, but the World Health Organization really wanted to know, are levels of mental illness different in different countries? So they set up an international consortium to measure it. And what they did was they took random samples of the adult population in different countries, and they gave them what are called diagnostic interview schedules, which is just lists of questions about symptoms of mental illness. So it's not asking people, are you depressed? Or have you ever been treated for depression? Has a doctor ever told you you're depressed? It asks about symptoms like lack of appetite or problems sleeping. And then those symptoms are all clustered into different diagnoses, and you get an estimate of how many people in the population have had some kind of mental illness in the past year. So what we're looking at here is the level of mental illness among adults in the past year, the percentage of adults who've had any kind of mental illness. In the more equal countries on the left, it's quite low, it's less than 1 in 10. But it's up to 23% in Australia and the UK, and 26% in the USA, so more than 1 in 4. So that's a huge difference between the more equal countries and the more unequal countries. And it's such a high prevalence in the more unequal countries that we can be sure that this isn't just something that affects the poor or a particular group in society. The prevalence is much too high. So I think this is a sort of a key thing to understand. And what I'm going to talk about now is really how inequality might cause those differences between different countries. We've spent a lot of time in the years since we wrote our book, The Spirit Level, answering various critics about whether or not this is a causal relationship. It is, of course, a statistical relationship. We can't do experiments and assign the UK to become more equal and another country to become more unequal, unfortunately, and then see what happens. It's observational work. And so thinking about whether it's a causal relationship isn't as simple and straightforward as if you can do experiments. If I had a pound for every time someone has said to me, correlation does not imply causation, I would be in the 1%, the top 1%, and maybe have different thoughts about inequality entirely. One of these days, I'm really tempted to say, gosh, I hadn't thought of that. But we have thought of it. And in 2015, we published a paper which lays out our explanation of the causal processes and a review of the evidence. So if anybody is interested in that, that's the reference. It's published in Social Science and Medicine. If you can't get a copy, I'd be happy to email it to you. But I'm going to assume now that we all accept that this is a causal relationship and go on to think about why. When we were writing our book and thinking about how it is that inequality affects people, what we were relying on for interpreting the relationships that we were seeing, like the ones I've just shown you, was experimental evidence from different disciplines. So not from within public health or epidemiology itself, but things that were being produced by other scientists in other disciplines that helped us think about the causal processes. And one of those disciplines was psychology. Are there any psychologists here in the audience? Anyone want to admit to having studied psychology or being trained as a psychologist? No? Because they do quite nasty things to people. Oh, there's one over here, is there? You do quite nasty things to people sometimes in lab settings. And one of the things that psychologists have been interested in for a long time is what kind of things do human beings find stressful? And they've done endless experiments where they bring people into a lab, and it's usually students who do it for a few quid, right? And they give them an unpleasant task to do, and then they measure their stress hormone levels. And these researchers, Dickerson and Kameny in California, asked the question, what kind of unpleasant tasks most reliably raise people's stress hormones? So they reviewed all of the studies of this kind that had been done. And I think they had, I was getting the numbers wrong, but I think it was over 200, I think it was 270. So it turned out that tasks with what they call social evaluative threat were much more stressful than any other kind. So if I gave you all some maths questions to do right now, a little maths test, some of you would hate it, some of you would love it, some of you wouldn't mind it. You wouldn't find it that stressful. But if I asked you to do the maths test and then read out to everybody your score, that would be a lot more stressful, okay? Because it's tasks where other people have got the chance to judge you and to judge you negatively that are most stressful. So if we measured everybody's stress hormones right now, mine would be high and yours would be low, because public speaking is one of the most stressful things that people ever do. It really reliably gets the cortisol up, because everybody has a chance to judge you negatively, positively. So writing about an unpleasant experience isn't that stressful, but being videotaped talking about it is. So that was one sort of piece of evidence coming from psychology, suggesting that it is how other people view us that we find the most stressful. More evidence came from a different kind of psychological experiment, and these are known as stereotype threat experiments. And in this particular one, researchers from the World Bank brought Indian schoolboys into a classroom setting, and they gave them tests, they gave them puzzles to do. They were those maze puzzles, you know, where you have to find your way from the outside into the middle, and they had to see how many they could do within a given time. And they did that under two conditions. First, when the boys didn't know each other's caste, and then again, when they'd had to go around the room and announce their caste to one another. And the scores of the high caste boys are in blue and the low caste boys in that sort of burgundy color. When they didn't know each other's caste, they did equally well. but after their caste had been announced, the performance of the low-caste boys plummeted because they're aware of the stereotypes that are held about their intelligence, their cognitive performance, etc. In the US, researchers have shown the same thing for black versus white college students and high school students. If they're just given tests and told it's a test, they do equally well. If they're told it's an intelligence test, the black kids do less well because they are aware of the stereotypes that are held about them in US society. And ladies, I am afraid we do the same with tests of maths and spatial relationships. If we're just given them, we do fine. We do just as well as the guys. But if we're told that science has shown women aren't very good at these, we don't do as well. And in fact, we're so sensitive to this that we only have to tick a box at the beginning of the test that says male or female for our performance to go down. If we tick the box at the end of the test, no effect. But at the beginning, so we're powerfully affected by what we think other people think of us. And not only does it affect our physiology, our stress hormones, it affects our cognitive performance as well. Very important for those of you who are educators of any kind, working with kids or adult learners of any age. And then the third kind of experiment we're aware of also comes from psychology, but this one you really couldn't do with humans, okay? So in this experiment, it's with monkeys. And monkeys are different to humans, but not that different. And in this experiment, the researchers had monkeys, and they had them living separately on their own, in their own little cages. And they looked at their brains, they scanned their brains, and what they're looking for here, this is very non-technical talk, is happy chemicals, okay, in the monkeys' brains. And then they put them in groups, and they waited a while and let the groups form hierarchies, dominance hierarchies, pecking orders. And then they looked at the monkeys' brains again. And here are the monkeys that are going to become dominant when they're living on their own, and here are the monkeys that end up becoming subordinate when they're living on their own. There isn't much difference between the level of happy chemicals in their brains. When they start to live in groups and they form their pecking orders and their hierarchies, the monkeys who become dominant in that setting are very happy. It's really good to be top monkey, okay? If you're top monkey, you get more of everything. You get more food, better shelter, more sex, everything. Better nesting materials and sites, the whole works. If you're a subordinate monkey, bottom monkey, it's not much fun living in a group. It's no better living in a group to living on your own. You might as well be on your own, because there's no real benefits to being in a group. In fact, you're much more likely to be the victim of aggression and bullying and being sidelined and pushed out for things. Now, you could actually do all of that with students if you had enough halls of residence to sort them out. But you couldn't do the next part, because in the next part, they taught the monkeys how to self-administer cocaine, right? And these monkeys just didn't bother. They just didn't take much. And these monkeys took a lot. And when they had the cocaine, their brains looked like these brains. They lit up like little Christmas trees. So in effect, the monkeys were medicating themselves against their social pain. And I know we have to be careful about extrapolating from monkeys to humans, but let's not forget how much of our DNA we share with monkeys. Well, let's not also forget how much we share with banana as well. We mustn't take it too far, okay? But I think we learn important lessons from looking at animal experiments and thinking about dominance, hierarchies, if we're trying to understand how inequality affects our biology, our emotions, as well as our cognition, as well as our levels of stress hormones. These are not happy monkeys. So that was the kind of evidence we had at the time. And I can remember going back to the University of Chicago, where I had started my academic career, after the publication of our book, and presenting all of the evidence we had on the impact of inequality. And somebody asking right away, because they're a quarrelsome lot at the University of Chicago, before we'd even got very far, it's like, well, you haven't actually shown us that people are more anxious about their status in more unequal societies. That's what you're hypothesizing is going on, but you haven't actually shown us that. And we hadn't. There was no evidence, but now there is. So this paper was published in 2014, and it actually looks at people's anxiety about status in different European countries. So the data come from the European Social Survey, random samples of the population again, but people are asked about how anxious they feel about their social status. And we've got three lines here, and the top line is the level of status anxiety in the most unequal societies, and the bottom line is the level of anxiety in the more equal societies. And you can see that levels of anxiety are higher in the more unequal societies. But what we're looking at sort of across here is the levels of anxiety in the poorest people in society across to the richest people. So over here we have people in the richest tenth of the population, and over there the poorest tenth. And so levels of status anxiety are higher in more unequal societies, not just for the poor but for everybody, all the way up to the top. So wherever you are in society, your status anxiety will be lower on average in a more unequal society. So whether you're well-educated, high-income, unemployed, whatever, inequality is having an effect. So that's been a powerful piece of evidence that's been very supportive of what we were hypothesizing. But as well, science has moved on in other ways. And we came across this review by Sherry Johnson, another psychologist, looking at studies of psychopathology, so looking at studies of different kinds of mental health problems and illnesses, in relation to what's called the dominance behavioral system. So this is a neurological system present in humans and in all sorts of animals down to the very lowest that controls or how we behave in relation to hierarchies. And looking at all kinds of research, including self-reports, observational studies, experimental studies, and biological methods, what they found in their review was that externalizing disorders, so these are sort of aggression kinds of problems, or hyperactivity kinds of problems, mania and narcissism were related to being more motivated to be dominant. And inflated self-perception of your own sense, of yourself. And that internalizing disorders, which are anxiety and depression, were more common among people who were sort of feeling subordinate, feeling submissive and trying to avoid subordination. So it's as if we've got this whole continuum of ways in which we can respond to a dominance hierarchy. We can either go under, be depressed, become anxious, withdraw, or we can sort of attempt to bluff it out and sort of claw our way up, make the best of it, and be, you know, work our way up to the top. So that was very helpful. So then we started to think about the different ways you can react to an unequal society, the different problems that might be seen in a more unequal society, that we would expect to see more depression, more anxiety, but we would also expect to see more narcissism and problems of that sort. And that's what we really sort of have been working on recently, is reviewing that evidence and creating some ourselves in that arena and looking at the different ways that people can respond. So I showed you right at the beginning a chart linking mental illness of all kinds to inequality in different countries. Here's a study looking at depression in relation to income inequality in US states. Those little abbreviations are for the different US states. It's a statistically significant relationship, higher levels of depression in more unequal US states and lower states of depression in the more equal states. And we're seeing that in several studies, in international comparisons as well as in the states. And this one looks at schizophrenia. So heightened levels of schizophrenia in countries with higher levels of income inequality. And we wrote an article for the New York Times about this sort of evidence. And a psychiatrist got in touch with me from the States, and he said, is that really true? You know, can it really be true that more unequal societies have more schizophrenia? Because it undermines everything I've ever thought about schizophrenia. I thought it was all genetics. Well, it's clearly not all genetics. And actually, if we look at studies of migrants, migrants tend to have higher levels of schizophrenia after migration than their populations from which they are coming have. So there's a sense of sort of schizophrenia being a reaction to being unsettled or not being sure of one's place in society that perhaps is being picked up here. And another recent study looked at the health of migrants to the United States. And if they had come from a more equal place to the US, their health tended to deteriorate with time in the US. But if they came from a more unequal place to the US, their health tended to improve. So these are quite powerful studies showing how important the social determinants of health are, how much they override individual factors, really. And we had been quite intrigued by a particular research finding that we were sort of struggling to explain. And this happened in the context of replying to critics of our work. About a year after our book had been published, we were asked to add a chapter responding to critics. And as part of that work, I went and looked up all the new studies that had been done of income inequality and health, hoping, of course, that they would agree with what we had found. And I found 9 new international comparison studies. And 7 of them did agree with what we had found. So I was very happy. And 2 of them did not. So there's that initial kind of clenching of the stomach and have you got it all wrong kind of moment. And then I realized that those 2 studies looked at self-rated health and not actual measures, objective measures of health like death rates or life expectancy, objective measures. And then Danny Dorling, a health geographer in the UK, some of you may know his work, published a paper comparing levels of self-rated health to actual levels of health in different populations, and they don't match up at all. It's really interesting. So if we look at Japan at the top, it has the highest life expectancy in the world, 82 years when these data were collected. And if you remember from my earlier chart, they do very well on a whole range of health and social problems. They're a very equal society. Their health is excellent, but only 54% of them say their health is good. If you look at America at the bottom, they have the worst life expectancy of all the rich developed countries, only 77 years on average, despite spending more than any of the other countries on healthcare. But 80% of them think their health is fabulous. Okay? So these things just don't match up at all. In fact, they are almost statistically significantly negatively correlated with each other. And certainly, if you've got a relationship between income inequality and real health, You're not going to find one with self-rated health because they don't travel together. Now, within any society, self-rated health is quite a good predictor of whether you're sick or whether you die. It's just that comparing it across different societies, it's not. And what that means is there's something culturally really interesting going on about the way people describe their health in more and less equal societies. So when we looked at this, we hypothesized that in more unequal countries where status and anxiety is more important, it's more important to show yourself in a good light, to put on a good front, to keep your end up, to present yourself to the rest of society as somebody worth something. But again, we were just guessing. And now there's a study that shows that that's true. So this is a study looking at levels of income inequality across the bottom, the more equal countries on the left, the more unequal ones on the right, in relation to what's called self-enhancement. And self-enhancement is a term psychologists use for basically thinking you're better than you are. In this case, it's thinking you're better than average. So any of you have ever listened to Garrison Keillor's Lake Wobegon tales on Radio 4, which come from America, knows that he's describing a place where all of the children are above average. Yeah, can't happen. I always thought Michael Gove got that particularly wrong about our educational system, wanting all our schools to be above average. But if you actually go out and ask Americans, are you a better driver than average? I think it's 96% of them say yes, okay? If you ask Swedes, it's only about 2/3 of them. There are still too many, okay, but there's clear differences. This measure of self-enhancement, people were asked all kinds of things. Are you a better driver than average? Are you more intelligent than most people in your population? Are you better looking? Are you nicer? You know, do you earn more money, et cetera, et cetera? And in more unequal countries, more people self-enhance and present themselves as better than average. So it's probably not surprising to see narcissism rising with rising inequality. Now, narcissism is an interesting phenomenon, and psychologists have only started to measure it properly fairly recently. What they used to measure was self-esteem, okay? And we all think we know what self-esteem means. But when they looked at levels of self-esteem in different groups, the results were really surprising. So the group in the USA with the highest levels of self-esteem turned out to be African-American men, who are probably the group who are most discriminated against and treated with the most prejudice. But they're obviously self-enhancing, because it's really important if your status is threatened to say you're okay. So measures of self-esteem are picking up on something that we actually don't think really is self-esteem, because if we had to sort of sit down and write a definition of self-esteem, it would probably go along the lines of something like a realistic appraisal of your own capabilities and feeling good about them. It wouldn't be an unrealistic one. But the measures that people were using to capture this were getting both kinds. And so measures of self-esteem for some groups were being inflated by self-enhancement. And what you actually need to do is be able to tease them out. Well, we now have things that measure narcissism specifically. And indeed, there is a thing called the Narcissism Personality Inventory, which you can do yourselves online, okay? I highly recommend it. Just go online, you'll find it really, really easily. And you answer 20 questions. I think they're paired statements, and you have to say which you agree with, okay, out of the two statements. So I was doing this while engaged in this sort of research, because I thought it'd be interesting. And some of the statements are quite difficult to do. So there's things like, I love to look in the mirror, right? Versus, I hate to look in the mirror. Well, we all know that sometimes you don't mind looking in the mirror on a good hair day and, you know, everything's going right. And other days you don't really like it, but you've got to pick one or the other. So it's a bit black and white, but you work your way through it. And I was working my way through it and thinking that I was okay and I wasn't a narcissist. And then I came to the statement, do you think the world would be a better place if you were in charge? And I thought, well, I do really. You know, I mean, there's one or two things I'd do that would just improve things a whole lot right away. Just one or two things. So I said to Richard, I'm like, oh God, I'm a narcissist. I think the world would be a better place if I was in charge. And he goes, oh, it would not, Kate. He said, you've got no idea of the unintended consequences that would flow from your ideas about how to make the world a better place. And so he's right. But actually, the statement paired with that was something like, you know, I would be frightened to be in charge of the world. Something which is also true. So I think I passed. Anyway, have a go. Narcissism only started being measured in samples in the US in the 1980s, because it was only around then that they started figuring out the difference between it and self-esteem. And Jean Twenge, a California-based psychologist, has been studying this for a while, and she's actually written a book which I would highly recommend called The Narcissism Epidemic, which tracks this rise in narcissism in the US population. And here, what she's really looking at is young people, because all the studies are of school students and university students. And in fact, narcissism is rising so rapidly and to such an extent in the US, you can't really use measures of self-esteem in US student populations anymore, because they all score at the maximum. So there's no differentiation between them. And her book is full of really funny stories, like the bride who had the cake baked in the shape of her for her wedding. And the people who rent out crowds, they rent out crowds to follow them around, and paparazzi. So you can rent paparazzi to follow you around taking pictures of you. The girl who wanted the street closed and red carpet laid out for her to get into her car to go to her high school prom, and things like that. But it's not nice, really, to laugh at other people, because actually narcissism is a quite horrible problem for those who suffer from it, but more particularly for their friends and their families and their colleagues. You know, it's not a pleasant condition for anybody around, and it's been rising with that rising level of income inequality. And of course, there's also studies looking now at how rich people behave compared to poorer people. Paul Piff, another Californian psychologist, they've got a lot of them over there, has shown that people driving high-status cars are more likely to cut off other people at an intersection or not allow old ladies to cross at the zebra crossing. He's also shown that high-status individuals are more likely to behave unethically, in less pro-social ways, and more narcissistically. In one experiment, they were even more willing to take candy from children. When in a sort of lab situation, there was a box of sweets on the table, and people were told, those are for the kids in the experiment down the hallway, but you know, you could have some if you want. High-status people take more. But a hopeful thing is that if you actually get people to think about justice and equality and egalitarian values, their behavior changes. So he does a series of experiments when he's comparing people with low social class to high social class, and here he's comparing them on a measure of narcissism, in two conditions. One when, you know, they're just sort of left to their own devices, and one when they get what's called an egalitarian prime. Before they took part in the experiment, they had to sit down and just write a few sentences about why all people should be treated equally. And if they'd had to do that before they took part in the experiment, bottom line, not so much difference between high and low social class people compared to the top line when they hadn't had that prime. And I think that's a really hopeful, sort of optimistic finding, because it suggests that you can change people's behavior by getting them to think about values and equality. And so that's possibly got really powerful policy implications. Just to sort of finish up this idea of there being different ways you can react to hierarchy, status issues, inequality in society, you can go under with depression or anxiety, you can withdraw. You can fight your way up, become narcissistic, self-enhancing. But of course, there's a sort of a third way, and that is to sort of medicate yourself against those problems. We find drug use, alcohol use, overconsumption, obesity and overeating, all of those sorts of problems are more prevalent in more unequal societies as well. Here's a Louis Vuitton trash bag. And there are new studies from the USA showing that people who live in more unequal areas have high levels of conspicuous consumption, more likely to buy high-status cars, more likely to be looking for status goods on the internet. All of that has environmental implications, so that inequality becomes an important barrier to sustainability. And all of this affects how we all interact with one another. So there's this deeply personal level on which we might become depressed or anxious or narcissistic or aggressive or involved with drugs or alcohol, but also all of our interactions with one another are affected by inequality. So levels of trust decline, that's what we're looking at here in more unequal societies and in more unequal US states. And in the past year, Richard and I have been to three very unequal countries where we were really struck by the lack of social cohesion and the damage that inequality does to levels of trust in society, to levels of crime and violence, and to the extent to which people attempt to sort of segregate themselves off from one another, defend themselves against other people in society. This is Mexico City, razor wire on the top of everybody's house, everybody trying to defend themselves from other people. This is South Africa, where it's not just razor wire, it's an electric fence above the gate. It's armed response. You know, if you try to get in, they'll shoot you. And if they don't get you, the big dogs will at the back over there. Every house protected like that. And we've just come back from Chile, where we saw the same thing, so electrical fences on houses in rich areas. And in lots of these countries, people view their social problems as particularly theirs. So in Mexico, people will talk about having a high level of violence because there's something peculiar about Mexican culture, the levels of machismo, that kind of thing, and not recognizing that actually they have the same kinds of issues as South Africa or Russia because of the levels of inequality within them. So inequality is deeply damaging on both the social level, the community level, as well as on a personal level. So I want to just end now by thinking about how we take that research, that body of research. You know, it's not just ours, it represents research across a huge variety of disciplines from a huge number of people across the world in different universities. What do you do with that knowledge, and how do you try to use it to create social change in a world where perhaps there's a current appetite or at least willingness to think about alternatives to the kind of capitalism that we've experienced over the past 30 whatever years. So post the global financial crisis, what can be done? And we've tried to work on several levels. One is internationally, and the sense in which the world is a very unequal place has been really picked up by Oxfam recently, which is a very good thing. This is a couple of years old, the 85 richest people owning the same wealth as the 3.5 billion poorest people on the planet. I think that number's 63 now in their most recent 2016 data. So fewer people than would fit on one bus, which does give you some ideas about where you might take that bus, doesn't it? owning the same wealth as 3.5 billion poor people. There's an appetite for thinking about levels of inequality at the international level that wasn't there before. It's now regularly on the menu at Davos. And it's regularly pegged as one of the most important problems the world faces by economists and business people gathering there. And one of the things that was rotating as you all came and sat down were comments from world leaders that I put together about how they view inequality as an important thing. The United Nations commissioned the government of Bhutan to define a new economic paradigm, and we were fortunate to take place in that. So we spent time out in Bhutan with Buddhist monks trying to come up with a new economic paradigm for the world. There was a lot of disagreement and debate. This is a leading Buddhist monk from Bhutan sitting next to the previous statistician of the OECD and member of the Italian government. They're trying to puzzle out a new way to do things, and that's what they came up with. Sticks and pieces of paper, which has since been developed into a new model for how we might think about the economy, and that's sort of being pushed at an international level by various groups of people. And we co-founded a virtual think tank at an international level to try and work on this. And the Sustainable Development Goals, which were signed up to by all the countries, all the signatories to the United Nations, 193 countries in September last year, give us, for the first time ever in the world, a framework for thinking about development that affects all countries. These replace the old Millennium Development Goals, which were only about poor countries, raising levels of infant and maternal health, clean water, that kind of thing. But look at Goal 10, reduced inequalities. Reducing inequalities within and between countries is now a goal for the entire world. There will be targets attached to that goal. There will be monitoring systems. So it's the next step beyond the rhetoric of the world leaders to have a framework to work with. It's still a long way from achievement, but it's an important part of the process. We can now hold our government accountable to all of these goals. And China, for instance, is thinking really hard about how you connect sustainability issues with economic issues. And do you do things differently as opposed to just going for GDP at all costs? Andrew Sims, who used to be at the New Economic Foundation, wrote a fantastic book, and it was excerpted in The Guardian. And in it, he describes this place called Goodland, where everything is absolutely fantastic. And the point about Goodland is it doesn't exist, right? But every single thing described in it exists somewhere. So there is a country where the president doesn't live in the state mansion and just accepts the median wage of the national average wage of the country. There are places where the people have rewritten the constitution. There are places where the environment has been promoted more than in others. So all of these things are happening somewhere, and really what we're looking for are ways to bring them all together. At a national level, I feel we've been far less successful in achieving any kind of traction with reducing inequality. We have a government currently whose leader, when in opposition, said he thought that inequality was really important, that he wanted Britain to be a more equal place, and even name-checked our work and said that we had shown how important it was. But we all know what's happening to inequality in this country today, and things are getting worse and not better. So at a national level, although we continue to try and have an influence, I think it's much harder. We co-founded the Equality Trust to try and educate and campaign for greater equality. It's now a charity and it has a lot of resources, if any of you are interested, and local groups. But I feel it's actually at the local level that we've been able to do more work. We've worked on the Living Wage Commission. I'm going to skip that in the interests of time, but also on local fairness commissions. And there've now been more than 15 of these in local authorities across the UK, where local authorities are trying to think about how to reduce inequalities in their area. They have all committed to paying a living wage within the councils. Some have committed to requiring that the companies with whom they procure and contract pay the living wage as well. And my own city, York, is one of those. So if you want to do business with City of York Council, you pay the living wage. And these are ways in which good practice becomes spread throughout the community. I think there's more than I've listed here, but those are areas where fairness commissions have been in place. They've called for things like increased job opportunities for youth, trying to do things around improving housing, debt and credit, etc. They all work in different ways, but I'm more impressed by what's happening at a local level and an international level to reduce inequalities than I am by what's happening at our national level at the moment. We keep working to try and make these connections between sustainability and inequality. So we've written something recently for the Fabians, which is available online and free. And a film has been made about our work, which will be released in April. And again, this is just an alternative way, I suppose, of reaching people. Because although I showed, as a bit of a joke, that figure right at the start, which is just that, you know, problems go up when inequality goes up. Some people don't even like that much of a figure. You know, some people don't read newspapers where we might write an article or read the kind of books we might write. People need to be communicated with in different ways. People respond to different kinds of ways of thinking about information. And I've come to realize that things like film, theater, animations, cartoons, songs, all sorts of ways of using the arts to communicate issues are just as important and valid as, you know, as a paper in the New England Journal of Medicine or something like that, and perhaps far more important. I'll leave up those websites for you in case you'd like to find out more, but I'll stop there, and I'm afraid I've gone on far longer than I intended to, but I hope we have a bit of time for questions. Yeah, thanks for listening.
We've got about 10 minutes for questions, so who would like to, we'll bring a mic.
I'm William Hyde, local resident. My question is, one of the early slides you showed, there was a massive outlier of Italy, way down here. Is there any things to learn from that sort of thing?
Outliers are always interesting, right? Because you can always tell a story about an outlier. And actually, in epidemiology, we're really good at stories about outliers. We can always think of a reason why Italy, you know, doesn't fit the pattern. For mental illness, who knows? It could be something to do with family cohesion. It could be something to do with religion. I don't know. I can only speculate. I suppose I'm much more interested in the common variants than the outliers. Because for every outlier, there's probably a different story. So if you have two outliers on a graph, they might be outliers for completely different reasons. But inequality as a shared root cause is what's of interest. But you're right that there might be implications, things we can think about.
Social researcher with an interest in poverty, deprivation, inequalities in South Africa. I think your international data around country comparisons is really important. I suppose looking forward to looking at the linkages between poverty, deprivation, inequality, and the other social outcomes like crime, my question to you is, what do you think about kind of the subnational picture? One of my interests is in how people's lived experience of inequality varies depending on where they live, their social interactions, their routine activities, and how that might kind of construct social attitudes, community context that might generate the crime. Because crime, obviously, things like that is like quite neighbourhood-based phenomenon.
Yeah, I mean, locally, but you know, they are really sort of place-based. So, you know, if you look within the UK, you'll get gangs in particular places and not in others. And so they always need to be understood in that context. But of course, in the bigger context, you get gangs in places that are deprived in relation to the national standard of living, in effect, the average levels. I met a researcher, social researcher in Chile, just recently, who was really interested in gangs and wanted to apply for a research grant to try and do some work with local gangs in Santiago to think about how to help boys avoid joining gangs. And I said, why don't you just try and get the poverty reduced, you know, in the area? Because I think unless we do have those big structural changes, then the local conditions which create the gangs or the crime will just be recreated over and over again. And so although we might apply local solutions, and they might be effective and, you know, help change individual life trajectories and do a lot of good, unless we change the broader social environment, they'll just keep coming up and coming up. So we need all of those things. You know, we need the community engagement and the local programs, but we really need to be acting at a national level as well and trying to draw attention to those broader structural determinants, I think. But, you know, we all need to sort of hold hands while we're doing all of those things and reinforce one another's research findings and interpretations.
Thanks for that, Kate. My name's Paul Hogan. I'm a college lecturer down the road on an access programme for adult learners. I'm also the UCU rec secretary. So I take your points about public speaking and the anxieties and the stress. And only yesterday I was observed and graded. And we've got this new culture of work through observations. And the stress levels are just the roof. But I'm absolutely convinced that if the union didn't exist in that workplace, it'd be a lot worse and a lot more fractious. So my question is really not so much about inequality and status and hierarchy, which we totally accept, but it's also about autonomy and democratic processes which allow people to have at least a voice and to question and to have an input into the way things work.
They're absolutely essential. What we've written about a lot in that Fabian pamphlet I mentioned is the need for more democracy within our institutions, workplaces, etc., and the need for more of us to have a voice and to be empowered to participate. Because all of this research does show that the more we're judged, the more we're subjected to hierarchy and judgment, the harder it is for us to be our best. This happens in schools, it happens in workplaces, and more democracy is clearly the way to counteract that. So whether that's things as simple as having employee representation on boards and committees that are important. I could have done a whole hour on that, really. If you look at union membership over time, it is the mirror image of levels of inequality. When one goes up, the other goes down. It's astonishingly how closely related they are. It may not be just about what unions can do for the pay levels of their members, but more that when you've got strong unions and wider union membership, it's reflecting a broader social movement and progressive politics in society as a whole. But you're absolutely right. And our institutions increasingly judge us in all sorts of ways that are inimical to us doing our best work and damaging to relationships as well. So I do think that's a really important area to work, and do please have a look and find some resources to help you in your UCU work and keep at it. Yeah.
Hi, Asakina. So I'm a health researcher. Can I, thanks very much for a fascinating and it's been really a great contribution to the question of inequality. Can I take you back to a point about inequality? I take it is socioeconomic inequality we're talking about. Now, I noticed that you don't, and your colleague also made a point of not talking about the experiment we did have inequality, and that's the socialist countries, where there was actually absolute socioeconomic equality. And I wonder if you could say one or two sentences about it, because I'm a bit concerned that if we do have total and absolute socioeconomic equality, what we do know from the socialist experiments is, and I lived in one, what we do know is that it doesn't actually reduce inequality as such. There are other hierarchies that quickly develop, and they cause probably similar levels of stress, etc., etc. I think that point, as a counterfoil to your argument, is probably you know, requires one or two sentences, maybe.
Yeah. If we look at the Eastern European countries, the countries that went through the socialist experiment, we couldn't get good data out of a lot of those countries for a long time. What is clear is that in the post-communist world, their health problems increased, and quite rapidly. Many of those countries lost life expectancy, which is in complete sort of contrast to what's happening in life expectancy everywhere else in the world, where it just keeps going up and up. And they became rapidly more unequal. What was going on within them at the time wasn't great equality, I don't think. It was incredible sequestration of power and lack of control and people not having autonomy. So it was an experiment that failed because it didn't actually do what it said on the tin. People were not equal in those societies. They were oppressed. They were unable to exercise democratic power. What would happen in a society that actually pulled it off and did it as it's supposed to be done? We don't know, because we don't have any examples like that. We don't have examples of utopian states where incomes are equal, genders are equal, ethnic groups are equal. We don't have any like that. All we can talk about really is what happens in the countries that exist. And what we see in the rich developed market democracies is that greater inequality leads to better health and social outcomes, as far as those countries have become equal. But even the most equal of them, Sweden, Japan, Denmark, Finland, are not perfectly egalitarian places. You know, they have Sweden, for instance, quite high levels of income inequalities that it redistributes. So we're certainly not advocating a perfect equality, because we just don't know what would happen in those circumstances. And I think we can certainly look at the communist experiment as a social and health failure, but probably not because of anything to do with equality of incomes, but for other reasons as well. They're really interesting countries to study, and they're changing inequalities and changing health and social problems make for a sort of fascinating laboratory of how things can go horribly wrong. But we'll just have to keep watching in the future. I'm not sure that's a really good answer to your question. But I suppose the point is that our work is empirical. It is grounded in what countries are actually like. And we can only dream of what they might be like if we manage to fix all of the different kinds of intersecting inequalities, which all tend to reinforce one another.
Okay, we take just two more, is that okay? There is tea and coffee. so we can carry on the conversation outside if you want to speak on the stage. We've got one person there and then another person in the front. This is Richard.
I'm Gareth and I'm an accountant. So my question is, in your opinion, do you think the current capitalist system that we live in, is that set out to increase inequality, or is that just an unfortunate byproduct that perhaps the policymakers aren't aware of?
That's a really interesting question. I would say that when the neoliberal experiment kind of started up, the idea was that inequality didn't matter because we would have trickle down. There might be inequality at first, but then we'd have trickle down, rising tide, lifting all boats, you know, and everybody would become more prosperous. I also think that there wasn't a recognition at the time, and the data weren't available at the time to show that inequality itself had damaging effects on society and health and things like that. Now we do have that evidence, so it's much less excusable now to say that you're accepting of a level of inequality. But there are plenty of people who still have misguided ideas that are not based in the evidence about inequality being necessary, say, for creativity, innovation, technological change. You hear that all the time. Everybody remember Boris Johnson and the cornflake packet, you know. Some people are more intelligent than others. If you shake a cornflake packet, the intelligent ones will come to the top and they will go out and be wealth creators, technological innovators. In actual fact, inequality wastes human capital and human talent and potential. And in more unequal societies, we get more kids dropping out of school, lower levels of educational attainment, less social mobility, and less creativity, fewer patents per capita. So I think it probably was... I think the effects of inequality were an unfortunate byproduct of that vision of what economic growth was going to do. But there's no excuse for that anymore. Because we have data now that show that didn't work. And we have increasing evidence from economists that inequality is bad for economic growth itself. So Nobel Prize winning economists like Paul Krugman and Joseph Stiglitz writing about how inequality is bad for economic growth and for stability. So the reasons that you might accept a level of inequality are just diminishing over time. And the evidence that you would provide huge social and economic benefits is growing.
Thank you very much. Our top banana is, top monkey. Is it banana or a monkey? I don't know. I'll tell him tomorrow when he returns from London. So our VC is not here, and I think he would have enormously enjoyed the talk tonight, Kate. So you've got me a woman, don't judge me, sorry about that. But I think, you know, I can't begin to sum up the degree of provocation. Actually, we've heard some of in the room tonight, and I think everything you've said resonates very strongly, and we'll all have our own context in which it resonates for us. For me, I'm reflecting on it as somebody who has the privilege to work in a university, and therefore somebody who has the relative privilege, I think, to at least have some influence over young people and the contribution that they make to society. And I'm just reflecting on the fact that actually in universities we've seen a growth in issues around mental health, more and more students presenting with mental health issues, surveys that are telling us that actually relative to the rest of the population, students are unhappy. And these are people actually who do have relative privilege in society. And what are our responses to that? And actually, as a university, our response is quite often simplistic in trying to identify, you know, the material issues that are impacting. So students worried about student loans, students concerned about workloads, about having to work and study. And they're not simple things for the individual. But actually, what's the real cause of some of the unhappiness for students? And actually, for many of them, it's that they say, it's I don't feel that I'm making a valuable contribution. And perhaps our response as an institution and as a sector ought to be more about how do we support our students to make a valuable contribution to society and help to start to diminish the inequality, you know, as far as any of us as individuals can have that impact. And so maybe I think for us, some of my colleagues in the room, it gives us cause to think about our response and the contribution we can make, both as an institution and individuals. So, you know, it only remains for me, I think, to say a huge thank you to Professor Kate for taking the slow train from York and unfortunately probably the even slower train back to York and really making an enormous contribution both to this agenda, to Edge Hill University and the Institute for Public Policy and Professional Practice. We really appreciate the insights and your time. Thank you, Kate.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you.